Zach got a special stack.
What do you know about southern metal?
I don't. Anything.
Man.
So I say break it down.
Well, southern metal, man, is like the essence of southern metal, man. It's like heavy as fucking shit.
I think southern metal has more of a groove to it. It just has more soul, has more of a groove. We have more of a sway.
There's something unique, inherent about the southern experience, and when you couple that with metal, that creates like the sludge. Slayer with a swamp sickness in the south.
I don't think you can come up in this area and not be some way influenced by what goes on around.
There's just a lot of repression in the South, and that's where all the evil comes from, I guess. Having the society with just really their thumb down on you about everything.
It's a perfect example of, you know, the atmosphere influencing the music, you know?
It's more of a groove, you know? So I think Southern Steel, that's really what that has. It has its own smooth groove to it.
All the Southern bands have that. And again, it's sort of an intangible thing, but it's unmistakable. It's there.
I heard something in this kind of music that was like, this is the shit, you know? Like, this is really what I want to be a part of.
It's just one fucking gigantic, massive riff that steps on you the whole night.
Hey, there's something about gravy and sweet tea that just kind of slows you down.
It might be the sweet tea.
It might be the sweet tea. It might be the humidity in the summertime.
Heat and humidity, it does crazy shit to our brains.
Let the South melt in your mouth.
It's being tenacious, sticking to your guns, and knowing damn well that I can kick this band's ass, you know?
I mean, it might not be the Civil War, but the fucking South will rise again.
Here's this lyric of going south. I'm down south in Texas with the big skies above, loving the life I live, living the life I love. That's the words to live by, man. Everybody doing it is doing it because it's love, you know, and it comes back to that, you know. It's not hate, it's love, man. As much as hard as these heavy rockers, some of them talking shit, you know, it's like, it is about love, man. It's about family, it's about those beautiful things.
You can be born anywhere, but not everybody's born in the South. I mean, that's kind of its own thing. You know, you got the South and you got everybody else. I mean, it's different. It's not like everything else. You know?
People in the South are just, it's a whole nother animal, man. I mean, it's not like anybody's prejudice or anything like that. It's just, we're just trying to live and just be, just do this and just don't fuck with me, you know? One of those things. Because the South gets a lot of shit. It's like the one place that, you know, you can still make fun of.
I don't know why we got to get such a bad rap. When something goes bad, it goes South. That's bullshit.
If you're from the South, there's a distinct personality flaw that you have. That it's not really a flaw, but I guess to the rest of the country it is.
If it's LA or New York, one of the big cities, everybody's trying to hustle you. There's always an ulterior motive for everything. In the South, it's more of a laid back, kind of chill and take your time and you wait till the last minute to kind of get your shit done, I guess.
They're right when it says it's slow moving. It's slow moving because we're comfortable. And we're comfortable because we don't give a shit about what the fuck the rest of y'all have to say. You have to kind of just have a cool attitude, because if you come up here with preconceived notions and shit like that, you're gonna find hard times, you know?
To me, the South is all there is. We do this shit our own way, back-asswards. and proud fucking of it. White trashed and red naked.
The South is a special place, but it is troubled. It has a rich history filled with stories of triumph and defeat, joy and suffering, amazing creativity, and bitter close-mindedness. It is a place filled with contradictions and confusion. There are wonderful people here, kind and generous, intelligent and thoughtful, endlessly creative. But with the good also comes the bad. Hateful and ignorant people, destructive and violent. Those who have grown up here feel these tensions and struggle with ways to process them. Those who live outside the boundaries often misunderstand the events that continue to unfold here. The heavy music that has taken root here in the last two decades is a product of this environment. The musicians who have worked to create it often vent their frustrations, worries, pain, and torment. Many of these emotions are a direct result of the Southern experience.
I grew up in like a basic fucking middle class household, you know? Your basic family where, I mean, it was whatever. It was the ideal, I guess, kind of little thing. I wasn't rich or anything, you know? My dad worked two jobs. My mom was, you know, stay-home mom. And I grew up, I had two older sisters and one younger sister.
My memories of living in Georgia are really awesome. We, you know, I lived in, it was kind of like a cul-de-sac area. Classic 70s, there's kids around. We had a creek, so I'd go and catch crawfish to feed my fish.
Played in mud holes and built tree houses and tipped cows and played in their cow patties and shit like that.
I grew up in a small town called Dallas, Georgia, just about 2 hours west of here. It's one high school, one elementary, like real small, one traffic light, one everything. It's just nothing but rednecks and pickup trucks.
Really, there wasn't a whole lot to do except skateboard, and we were heavy in like BMXing, maybe go make some dirt hills or whatever and go make a ramp out of it.
I rode a lot of BMX as a kid and raced motocross. I was racing little MR50s, and we used to go back by the levee and make our own motocross tracks and do all that kind of shit, you know, and then you get to the age where you start smoking grass, you know, and you go back there and you do that too. And
we had like 8 acres of land. We were the only white people in our area, and we did a lot of acid and smoked a lot of weed, actually.
We used to follow the mosquito truck down the street, too. It was like the ice cream truck for us, you know?
He'd come and spray the cove, and we'd run out in the middle of the cloud,
just
man.
Just run down, chase the cloud of DDT down the street. I don't know, maybe that's why we like to get high now. I'm not sure, but...
A vivid memory would be getting picked up from nursery school. My aunt would pick me up. My mom would still be working. She'd pick me up, and she'd bring me to this place called the clinic. And what it was the mental health clinic that she was once an inmate of and became part of the staff. So I remember meeting
Mr. George,
and this is Miss
Francis.
I remember that type shit.
My biggest memories of a child, I guess, that was kind of fun was 4 months out of the year I'd spend on a farm in Jane, Missouri. So, you know, there was a lot of working the cows and chicken farms and stuff like that. So that was, you know, pretty intense.
From like from early age, actually, like was with my grandparents on the farm, literally like getting the eggs from the chicken and milking the cow. And like they grew all their own vegetables, like straight, like self-sufficient, which I hated at the time. I thought was like backwoods hick stuff, but like now it was really cool.
I just remember all kinds of animals, and you know, I wanted to be an animal. I used to pretend like I was a horse. I played with my dogs, you know, and they were like my friends because we didn't have any, you know, like a neighborhood with kids and stuff, like people who grew up in the suburbs or whatever. So kind of a weird, like, not a farm, even almost more extreme rural than that, just because it was just sort of living in the middle of nowhere.
My dad was a tobacco farmer. He had a tobacco farm, so I'd go up there with him and just hang out all day while he did all that and harvested the tobacco and stuff, and then he'd go up to Winston-Salem and sell it at an auction, you know, so I'd do that, hang out with my dad.
I am a hillbilly from the hills of eastern Kentucky. It was like an hour drive from Walmart, so, you know, really back in the hills. As a matter of fact, I'm the first male in my family that has not worked in a coal mine. Like my great-granddad lost both his legs in a coal mine. My grandfather had black lung. So those are my people.
I was to the family, man. When I say family, you know, I talk about my mother, my father, God rest their souls, and my brothers, God rest their souls, my sisters and my cousins and my friends and my loved ones and everybody who has that spirit. And we're talking about living life and how hard it is and how we keep on rolling. So give it up. Cheers. Cheers!
Southern musicians invariably have a strong connection to family. And music is a big part of many Southern families. Whether it comes from an exposure to gospel, bluegrass, classic rock radio, or simple church hymns, a connection to music is a natural thing for people of the South.
I remember we had a little bitty record player, me and my friends, and that TV show SWAT was out. And we put on the theme of SWAT, and we'd all get ready, and we'd put the record on, and we'd like, we were the SWAT team, bro. We'd run out, and we'd jump up on little trucks and shit, and remember?
You know, I guess this is about heavy music or whatever, but when I was a kid in you know, the 70s and stuff, I considered the disco music heavy stuff. And my parents were listening to Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin and stuff like that, but that was like my parents' music kind of at that time. My dad hated disco so much, so it was kind of like, in a weird way, it was kind of punk, you know, to be in a KC in a Sunshine Band and like get that record for Christmas and put it on and blast it and, you know, turn it all the way up, and my dad would just, don't fuck me, you know, with my stereo playing this shit, you know.
From like 8 to 10, music still wasn't coming into play. It was just a little bit. I got my first drum kit and then records when I was like, you know, 9 or 10 years old, and it was just getting ready to start getting in my blood.
I was 9 years old, I got my first guitar, and I wrote my first song, and I still remember it, though, most of it. And I'm not gonna sing it, nor tell you the name of it. Hey, hey, Mr. Joe. It was about the lawnmower man named Mr. Joe, who used to fucking mow lawns in my neighborhood, and about how poor he was and all this shit.
Flipping the dial, you know, on a radio, just trying to find something on my own to listen to when my parents were around. And it was actually, there was a rap station in town, and they're playing LL Cool J, Rock the Bells, and Dougie Fresh, and that honestly was what I thought at the time sounded the coolest on the radio.
Musically, kind of funny, the first music I really loved was like the old rap music with the breakdancing and everything, you know?
About the time I was 10 and breaking came out, I got into the first wave of rap, you know, when it was Nemesis and UTFO and stuff like that.
When breakdancing started taking off, I was hanging out with my friends breakdancing with them, but I would bring like Diary of a Madman. They told me, you can't breakdance to this. I'm like, look, watch, I can do it, you know?
When I was a little kid, I listened to a lot of Public Enemy and NWA.
My parents used to take those tapes and burn them. They took all my NWA tapes, they took all my Two Live Crew tapes, they took all my shit. My entire tape collection was in the fireplace, because my mom found the dirty tapes and burned every one of them.
A lot of the music that I was listening to was like Michael Jackson, Off the Wall. My parents loved Grease, so I was stuck listening to that 8-track for more times than I cared to.
We got in trouble one day because we skipped church because we were both sick, and you know, they came home, we were fucking cranking the Grease soundtrack. I was probably 6. Chuck was probably 9, and yeah, they were pissed.
Rhinestone Cowboy was my favorite song when I was a kid.
Rhinestone Cowboy, Glen Campbell. I remember that being one of my first 45s I got. My wife has a photo of me having the very first Kiss album, my cowboy hat on, my Kiss album in one hand, and a Glen Campbell album in another hand.
My thing when I was a kid, I was in the Kiss Army in second grade. I mean, I've always been rock and roll. Like,
I'd get anything that had Kiss on it, you know, anything. I had the bubblegum cards. I remember they even had a commercial on TV for the little Kiss radio. I recorded it, like just the audio from it in my little tape recorder, just so I could sit there and listen to, you know, it had an explosion in it. And ladies and gentlemen, you know, Kiss. So I was a Kiss freak.
Dudes in makeup that looked like hell and blood and fucking, I mean, I was just like, oh, this is awesome, you know?
I'd play sick from school, and I remember one specific time, I had like full Paul Stanley makeup on with Kiss Alive 1 cranked to the T, and I was doing the entire concert with a tennis racket, singing and mouthing words and stuff in front of the mirror in my bathroom, and my stepdad walks in and he says, thought you were supposed to be sick.
My dad was what I call dad rock. He, you know, he liked Wings, he liked Dire Straits, ELO, the Eagles, that kind of stuff. And so that's what I grew up on. And he actually encouraged my musical interest through Pain and Suffering, which was, we would drive around doing errands as parents do, and we'd listen to the radio, and he would say, okay, we're gonna bet. Whoever can guess the song quicker can get, you know, 5 cents. So he would bet me against my allowance. And so whatever song came on, you know, obviously he knew it, you know, and he would just be like, bah! Oh, missed 5 cents, sorry, son. And it would just, every time, so I lost, you know, he didn't have to pay me allowance for several years, so I got really good at like naming songs really quickly.
I grew up around all the Southern rock stuff. All my parents went to school with Marshall Tucker, and my stepdad was a keyboard and drum tech for Charlie Daniels. So all that was all around the house, always happening.
My pop was a gospel singer, Southern gospel singer, promoter. And I'd go to shows with him all over Georgia, all over the South and shit. And Wendy Bagwell and the Sunlighters was my first big introduction to music. You know, they had a song called Jesus Locomotive, I believe it was. Real chug-a-lug harmonica shit. And then Skinner and Charlie Daniels and Slayer.
You know, aside from buying a Striper record when you're in third grade, you know, to moving on to something different, you know, you get to junior high and some of the kids in the grade above you, you know, start giving you, I know that I had this New York City hardcore tape that was full of just hardcore bands. I had this Misfit tape that I sure the hell was always hoping my parents couldn't understand what they were saying.
Once I got out of elementary school and went into into high school is when I first got introduced to punk rock. The first tape that I ever owned, a copy of a cassette kind of thing, was it had a DRI's 22 song EP, and then on the other side was Fear the record. So that was my first introduction to what I think I really came to love, you know.
You know, around the same time I was getting into skateboarding and everything as well, you know. And that's when you had a lot of the bands like DRI and Corrosion of Conformity back then, and things like that, that, you know, was revolving around the whole skate scene. And the Dead Kennedys and the Misfits and Black Flag and, you know, all that shit.
And my oldest sister also listened to a bunch of different hardcore and punk rock and alternative stuff, I guess you would say. Turned me on to stuff like Black Flag and stuff like that when I was about 12 years old, I guess.
I just grew up on rock and roll, really. I mean, and then it got to the point I heard Black Flag and I knew that was fucking over, you know?
I remember my friend Patrick, he gave me Black Flag Damage. And that's it. I heard Greg Ginn's guitar. I borrowed my dad's guitar. He's been trying to teach me my whole life since I was, you know, a baby. And I didn't have nothing to do with it. I heard Greg Ginn. I borrowed his guitar and, you know, I played his guitar for years and years, you know.
It was the first stuff that I heard that made me decide that I was going to do something like this, something heavy. It was all the angst and anxiety in it, plus all the just fucking fuck you, you know.
It kind of boils down to stuff that scared the fuck out of me, you know, music that would scare me, and I thought, I just love that. I love the danger of the whole thing. And so I guess, you know, Kiss was dangerous when you were younger, but as you got older, I was like, that's, you realize it's fake, you know? So, you know, you see the Sex Pistols, you're reading about Sid, and you're like, you know, Dee Dee Ramone's like this drug addict dude, and you just like, man, this shit's like real. It's real, you know? It's not fake like Kiss.
And I'm hearing Black Flag, and I'm hearing, you know, all this music that I would, you know, was like, what the hell is this? It was like blowing my mind, you know what I mean? And that's, for me, what really like shifted gears from like the more stock, like, you know, Van Halen, Gritter Kids, you know, into like, you know, there's, you know, Bad Religion and stuff like that, that, you know, that's like your normal everyday folks that I was exposed to, they weren't listening to that, you know?
I'd say my biggest break from punk rock into what we are now would be in 1987 or 88 when I first heard the Melvins.
All these bands were influenced by so many different bands, but the band that sticks out a whole lot would be absolutely when the slow thing became really, really big, the Melvins' first record. The Melvins' first record was like the Bible to Jimmy Bauer for a while, and the second record. Yes.
Probably the most important cassette I ever got in my life. It had Trouble on one side and Melvin's, the 7-inch, their first 7-inch on the other side. And I've been fucked ever since. Totally, man. And the Melvins freaked it. They freaked me out. And I tried to make everybody into them as much as I could, you know.
The underground's a very powerful thing. And at the time, before the internet and all that shit, it was great because it was word of mouth, man. And it fucking worked.
There was no internet back then, so to find music that wasn't, you know,
whatever the mass populace is listening to is a lot harder thing to do. You know, you had to really look for it.
Back then, you actually had to do serious research. You had to get magazines and go to the record store and waste money on stuff that you didn't know was going to be good or not.
You start buying records just because of the way the cover looks, you know? All kind of crazy, Angel Witch and whatever, you know? Just if it had blood on it, you bought it.
And I just look for bands and look at their names and look and see what shirts they were wearing, and then that's how I would buy things. And so it'd be hit or miss. Some bands would be awesome. You get home and be like, awesome, buy it. You know, sometimes you get home and you want to sort of tape across the room because you wasted $10 on it.
When you grow up in the South, you grow up with religion. Some embrace it, others reject it, but we all feel its presence. It is in our schools, at our jobs, on the roadside, and on the radio. Although the heavy music that emerges from the southern states varies widely in style and tone, all of it is tinged with some strain of religion.
Well, my worn-out boots are taking me downtown, and I'm looking for trouble, and I want to get loud. Serve me up a drink, and I'll shoot it right down, and I'll jump up on the bar and holler one more round. I'm going straight to hell. Ain't nothing slowing me down. I'm going straight to hell. So you just better give me one more round.
Yeah, man, I'm very, very religious. I was brought up Baptist, and I got a strong relationship with Jesus. That's on a personal level. I don't sell it on nobody, but it's a personal thing, and it's not like all pastel paintings like you see, you know. This is fire and brimstone and, you know, throwing over the sales booths at the temple kind of shit. It's mad Jesus. Jesus with a bone to pick.
I don't know. I don't diss church. I think it definitely provides a service, man, and I actually like to think I can get a hold of it sometimes, and it works something for me. I know I'm not good at it, but you know, I'm better than not going. Maybe, I don't know.
Even if you don't even know that you've been shaped by it, you have. If you grew up in the South, the only time I ever went to church was summer times. I'd go up to my grandparents. House in Tennessee. We'd have to go Wednesday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, you know, go to revivals and all that stuff. So I did that, but I would come back to Georgia and my parents did not go to church. The only time I ever had to go to church down here is when the grandparents come visit. I have to act like I've been going the whole time, you know.
Well, when I was a little kid, my family would go every Sunday. And then as soon as we got out of church, my dad would get a bottle of Mad Dog and come home and get drunk and fucking start a fight and watch NASCAR, you know?
Well, my dad wasn't at church. My dad was a poking, playing, hell-raising redneck dude that fought for money. Like, if he thought that he could knock you out, he'd bet $40 to the bartender and y'all go outside and best man won, yeah.
I think we went when there wasn't a good football game on for dad. We put in an appearance, but...
We weren't like forced to go ever, but like
bullshit.
It was. Well, okay, yeah, we were forced.
I had got put in a Catholic school by some strange reason because we couldn't afford it. But my parents had died and they left me an inheritance, so my brother became my legal guardian, so it was kind of like he decided to put me in a Catholic school, you know? So there I was, you know, in this Catholic school, and I had chopped my hair up, it was all sticking up and shit. And you'd wear like the uniform, but you'd like unbutton it a little so they could see like the you know, UK subs or some logo, you know, like under your shirt. I'd put like a safety pin in my pants, you know, I'm like, I'm punk, you know.
I was in Bible school and shit when I was a kid. Church choir. The first time I sang was in church choir. Amazing Grace or Christmas special or whatever. But yeah, I mean, there's a little bit not involved.
I was an altar boy until I was about 12. I dug it, dude. I thought carrying the cross was heavy. That's why my tattoos are all religious shit.
Yeah, when I was a little kid, man, I was an altar boy, you know? And I did that, you know, and then I, you know, of course, you know, I was like 12 years old or something like that, got out of doing that. And then I didn't go to church for a while. And then one time I went with my mom to church when I was about like 16 or 17 years old, you know, going to hardcore shows and all stuff. But for whatever reason, I went with her to church on this one particular Sunday. And I guess the priest looks around the church and he don't see any altar boys, but he recognizes me from like 5 years earlier when I had an altar boy for me. And he pointed me to go into the, like the little, what they call the sacristy. And I went in there and I was like, what? He's like, I need you to help me serve mass. I was like, man, I can't. And you know, I'm trying to tell this priest like, no, but then I felt like, you know, like bad. So, I mean, they didn't even have robes big enough for me, dude. I was, you know, like, I couldn't even fit. I had to wear like a priest robe and serve mass. Some of my jerk off friends are out there, you know, like, and they see me and they're like, what the, you're an altar boy? You know, and I'm like, no, man, you know, like. So I never went to church again after. That was the last time I went to church. It's so embarrassing, humiliating, you know, and just, you know, I couldn't tell the priest no, though. I felt like, you know, and oh, God, it was ridiculous.
The type of music that we listen to, a lot of it, they kind of express religious and social ideals with that in many different ways. So myself, I mean, I'm more into black metal, all of that, so anything that's, you know, all about Satan, I'm a lot more into, you know.
Baptist, which now I'm satanic, Buddhist, Druid. Because my grandmother was completely like, I used to, you know, she used to dress me in my uncle's suits. They would pull me on stage, altar, and do the whole Southern Baptist thing, and it's just a big turnoff, and it scares the shit out of me.
That's what it is. Almost everybody grows up Southern Baptist down there, and as soon as you hit teenage years, you start telling your parents to fuck off, and you know, that's when you start getting into trouble and learning what you want.
You're gonna get religion shoved down your throat.
My mom was the biggest neo-Nazi Christian fucking Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday, Christian schools and all this stuff. She was shoving that shit down my throat, man, and burning my music and threatened to send me to Africa on boot camps for just listening to heavy metal. If you came over to my house with a Metallica Up Your Ass t-shirt on, you couldn't walk in the front door. And so there was all that stuff to just make me want to rebel even more against it. So I rebelled just naturally, not because I was raised in the Bible Belt, just because that's how the fucking way it was.
You know, I didn't really start rebelling or anything till the normal teenage kind of years, but once I did, that was kind of where I could really piss my parents off, was with religion. And I was like, so I decided I was going to be satanic, but not really, you know what I mean? I, you know, fucking just was evil as I could possibly be.
Man is an ignorant creature. Man is a hostile organism. I understand the fucking reason for religion and fucking law. But religion, the second you take in this so-called God that's invented to keep man in line, if you're good, you go to heaven, if you're bad, you go to hell. Any organized religion that has that credo, you automatically live with this fucking monkey on your back, thinking that everything you do is being watched. It's bullshit.
My parents came from Long Island, New York, Catholic families, and you had to raise your children Catholic. You have to at least get them confirmed and, you know, all that stuff. And at the time when they were getting divorced, like, the church is telling me that my parents are going to hell because they don't want to be together because they beat each other up. You know, it's like, okay, so you're telling me better for them to sit around and beat each other up than to split off and love their kids and love themselves and be happy people. So inevitably, I was that annoying. I was Lisa Simpson and you know, in church class and like going, so what about this? What about this? You know, and they just didn't want, you know.
One Sunday we went there and it was the record burning. They were showing all these films on like how like Hotel California was Satan. He was talking about, you know, that's Anton LaVey up here. You listen to this music and you're gonna go to hell, you know. So kids brought like AC/DC records and Kiss records and all this shit and they were burning them. I'm like, no. And they were telling me that I need to, you know, burn my records. Fuck you. I'm, you know, saved up grass cutting money and shit to buy all my records. I was like, as a matter of fact, I got tickets to Motley Crue in my back pocket, and I'm going tonight. So fuck y'all, I'm not coming back.
I guess Freud would call it the id and the superego, you know, always struggling with each other, you fear and what part that plays in love, you know.
The only proof to me that there's something else is the fact that there's music here for us to play. And, you know, it's so much bigger than we are that's all I need to know as far as my spirituality goes.
I think it's definitely an interesting play in a lot of the music. It's definitely religious background of the South. And I don't know, it's a different interpretation with many of these bands, so it's hard to say. I think that a lot of times that influences lyrics, though, and how songs are put together. So I can't say there's anything bad with it if it's also introducing new things to music, you know?
I mean, I Hate God was a reaction. It was shock value thing, you know? People think there's like some meaning behind it and all this. I'm like, no, it was basically just... It's just shock value to say, you know, we hate God. We don't give a fuck. We're going to say this, and it didn't matter, you know, so. There is a whole meaning behind it, but there was a singer before me who lasted like 2 weeks or something, and he kind of came up for the whole concept I is like the way you see things, and hate, like God is your vices, and like he had this weird thing about it. You know, you, the humans can't control the things they do, but they, you know, you hate them nonetheless. You know, like certain drugs or cigarettes or sex or something like that. Your money, you know, like vices. And he had this all in his. He was a tripped out acid head guy. He took a lot of acid and just said a lot of crazy shit. He's a born again Christian now, and that's a true story because some people don't believe that, but. When we first put out our first album, In the Name of Suffering, and it came out on CD and all that, Jimmy gave him a copy. He tossed it out the window. He was like, no, I can't believe I started this whole thing, you know, and like tossed it. We were like, wow, man, that's crazy.
I'm going straight to hell. Ain't nothing's holding me down. I'm going straight to hell. So you just better give me one more round.
Southern kids hear a lot of music, and when they combine this early exposure to rock, metal, and country with their actual life experience, new sounds and new styles of music are created. This is not always deliberate and definitely not unusual. In fact, it is in sync with history. No one set out to create the blues, it just happened naturally. Same with rock, bluegrass, and gospel. The modern bands making heavy Southern music are a product of their time, and so is their music.
I actually earned the money to buy my first guitar was working on my dad's shrimp boat. And I wanted to buy a Charvel, because at the time that was the hot guitar to have. And I saved enough money to buy that, but I didn't have enough money to buy the PV half stack that I want, so he had to lend me the money to buy it, and I had to work another sum, but I pay him back.
Once I started playing guitar, Led Zeppelin was one of my huge influences, and it was a goal of mine to learn every single song, and I had, you know, a checklist, and I sat there checking them off, and I got about 80% of the way through. So I was, you know, I was, yeah, kind of obsessed.
I wanted to learn, like, how to fucking just scream over everybody's nasty guitar riffs, and I just wanted to hear riffs. Like, I remember hearing Ride the Lightning, you know, and then sitting in class, in science class, and just deciding that, like, that was my calling, you know, that's what I was gonna frickin' do.
And I spent my final years in high school in a one-room apartment with my mom. I slept underneath the dining room table, and I had a blanket that went over my senior year and my junior year, and I had all my posters underneath the table, and you know, I had a little guitar and sitting there with a flashlight, and it was just this little, basically a coffin. Everybody was always weird about it because I'd never bring people to my house and shit, and I'd just show up at the shows and hang out and get out of there, you know. So, yeah, it was a strange existence for a while.
Well, basically I bought a drum set and my parents made me buy it. They were like, we're not buying this for you because the guitar lessons failed, the trumpet failed. So like, if you want to play drums, you have to buy the drum kit, which I'm sure for them was kind of like, oh, he's never going to save the money, and then we don't have to hear him practice. It's going to be great. It's not going to work out. No. I went and I mowed lawns for like a whole summer. I bought a crappy drum set from a crappy music store, and within a month of me buying it, some kids from the church group heard that I had a drum set and asked me to be in a band, and it was a punk band. So started playing in punk bands. That was pretty much all I knew until I came to Richmond, and then I heard I Hate God one day, and I decided, oh crap, this is awesome. I need to play in heavy music.
We're from New Orleans, Louisiana. We play slow like the way we work. Because we're from down south.
New Orleans in general, to me, it's a different city. Being from here, the atmosphere, the darkness of the city, the mystique of the city, all has to do with like the sound, the way things sound. And I think it's why New Orleans bands maybe sound a little different than other bands, or have, you know, whatever. Well, I think it's unique. So, you know, and it, I think it comes from just the whole doom and gloom of being from New Orleans. I mean, you can say you think it sucks to be from such and such in Tennessee or Alabama or anything like that, but it's like a love-hate thing with New Orleans, you know? You don't really like to live here, but you won't leave. I went to my first show, like I call like underground type show here in New Orleans, at this place called Robert's Playhouse. And it happened that day, it was a benefit, and all the local New Orleans bands played. It was Exhorter's first show. Mike Williams' old band, Suffocation by Filth, played. Graveyard Rodeo played, Viral Niles played, Shell Shock played, which is a band I wound up playing drums in.
When all these bands would team up and do these shows together, it was just like, motherfucker, man. It was amazing, and fucking the kids would come out in droves.
I just felt comfortable there. I felt, you know, like I had found my niche, you know? And there were so many different types of bands that day, you know, and Mike Williams walking back and forth, who looks like a little 13-year-old kid going, "Now fuck all, y'all think y'all are all cool, huh? Yeah, y'all think you're cool, yeah, who's got some drugs?" And, you know, I mean, yeah, Graveyard Rodeo fucking throwing fish heads and shit everywhere. And, you know, I'm just like, what's going on here? It's like a complete fucking freak circus. But I loved it, you know?
When I first joined Graveyard Rodeo, they were already a killer band, you know? And Tommy Scanlon and Doobie, the drummer and the bass player, we were kind of all on the same page. We didn't have samplers at the time, but we were using like cassette players and using Charles Manson snippets and hitting pause and, you know, just recording these screwed up things, and really started writing these 8 or 9 minute mind fuck heavy songs. Heavy wasn't even really a term used. It was just, you know, how to not be like everybody else. And ended up doing something, ended up being, having a feel to it. And then Exhorter was coming around, and so Graveyard Rodeo and Exhorter would play a lot together back in the day, and we would screw off all the clubs and rent VFW halls.
The VFW hall was a great little era, because that was like, that's when there was like a scene had started. I became like part of that scene, you know, like that's pretty much the only place everybody played at that time.
You know, the VFWs were literally sheds. The one on Franklin was a total just shithole shed that when people would start doing, you know, slamming and doing their thing, the fucking thing would shake, man. It would just go rambling around and go, and you feel like the floor was gonna fall out any minute.
And it was just a huge fucking like hurricane floor, p- pit, whirlwind just going on, you know, and that's the first introduction to that chaos. And you're standing there and it's just like, you don't know if you want to jump in or you get annihilated and you're just like, fuck it, go, and you just go.
The energy of the audience, there was such a beautiful, absolute, pure, it was of the times, but there was a seedy, punk, snotty, but very unified feeling when you're in that pit and you're insignificant and you're fucking going fucking crazy, and if someone busts their fucking ass, you got picked up.
Just being a part of it's fucking awesome. You know, at this point, you know, to see that there's so much attention on the scene here and being involved with the growth of it and see the bands and the evolution of it and everything. And, you know the people, you know, around, like, you know, like Jimmy and Philip, you know, and all those people and what they've done and how they've evolved in the scene, you know, from the early days of what Phil used to do and then he left and everything that evolved with Pantera and then, you know, Sammy with Acid Bath and everything that Acid Bath achieved, you know, because I think sometimes Acid Bath's overlooked a lot in this. I mean, they weren't from New Orleans, they were from the Bayou, you know, but they're still, that was an integral part of still Louisiana, you know, and that band, you know, moved a lot of shit for who they were.
Back then, nobody wanted to give two pisses for us, you know, when we came out, when we toured and stuff, you know, it started taking off a little bit, but it was still really discouraging at the time. Then it's like after we broke up is when shit took off, you know, and it's insane.
We used to play shows with them like it was nothing, you know, like, oh, we're playing with Acid Bath. And it's funny because when you're on the road and somebody's like, y'all know guys in Acid Bath? And it's like, yeah, it's like, dude, we see them like either every weekend or played a show with them last night. And they're like, oh my God.
It freaks me out as how many people know about that band with what we had to deal with as far as, how can I put this? As far as the little bit of promotion that was put into the band, as big as it got because of that. I guess it's like a good example of a word of mouth band, I guess you can say, you know?
Southern music scenes are often fed by, or in some cases entirely based on, word of mouth. This was true for New Orleans, a legendary city full of amazing bands and musicians of all styles. It is home to people like Pepper Keenan, Phil Anselmo, Kirk Weinstein, Jimmy Bauer, Mike Williams, and Ben Fogoust. Individuals who have been in Louisiana from the start and helped found the heavy music culture that thrives there still. In contrast, the scene in Athens, Georgia is younger and still growing, but it has all the proper ingredients to form the next big underground scene.
Yeah. 23 hours of sheer boredom, 1 hour of pure chaos.
It's funny, like, I think that Athens scene is a little more of, like that, a word, you know? It gets more hype without getting more recognition. People don't actually, like, see what's here. As far as heavy stuff goes in town, it begs for it. There's not enough of it.
One of the things that's most remarkable about Athens is how all the bands are playing together. We've played shows with Venice Is Sinking, who's sort of this atmospheric, pastoral, sort of, you know, just very mellow and serene. And we've played shows with hip hop bands, the Deaf Judges, and we, you know, everybody's friends. They all work in the same clubs. They all work in the same restaurants. People come out and people fill the house, and it works.
We're all buds, you know. Earlier, we're all helping each other load out our equipment, things like that, and we help each other get shows. I mean, that's what it's all about. You know, it's like we're all doing the same thing. We're just out here to fucking make ourselves feel great and share what we can't keep inside anymore. And yeah, Music Hates You is the shit.
Well, hey, man, I mean, you know, I'm a fan of Music Hates You before I'm in Music Hates You. If I wasn't in it, it'd still be my favorite band. It's just that band that I finally get to be in and not watch from the sidelines. And mainly, you know, a large part of it is influence from New Orleans bands and Savannah bands. You know, it's badass. I mean, Dude, I could go on for, you know, the next week about bands in Athens. I'm a huge fan. Athens rules. There's nothing else like it, and we're not talking a whole lot of people. It's kind of like Nashville. Everybody's in three bands, you know, except for Music HU. We ain't nobody allowed in no other fucking band in Music HU. This is it. That's law. I made that law, by the way.
We are Music HU. Suck it. Good night.
We flip the middle finger to each other. Because that's what it's about. Fuck your job, fuck your parents, fuck your girlfriend, fuck everything that's not right here in between us four. And then I say to them, thank you for playing music with me tonight. I love you all, and we're going to do this regardless of what happens. This is Music Hate You. This is this, and ain't nothing else. This is this. You know, I'm a fan of Music HU before I'm in Music HU. If I wasn't in it, it'd still be my favorite band. It's just that band that I finally get to be in and not watch from the sidelines. And from that point of view, this may sound very cocky, but I don't mean it to be. It's there ain't another like us. We stand alone.
There is a stigma attached to Southern bands, especially when they travel outside the South. The same could be said for individual Southerners. But for some reason, the effect is magnified when vans full of bearded, tattooed long hairs travel outside the invisible regional bounds. Some people assume we are illiterate, ignorant, even violent. Of course, this is usually not the case. In reality, there is a lot of racism in the South, and those who grow up here see it. But musicians are inevitably thinkers, and racism does not stand up to thought. Nevertheless, Southern musicians often feel the sting of judgment from those who do not understand the complexity of life here. Perhaps the most obvious symbol of this disconnect is the Confederate flag, an image contaminated by years of pain and suffering. To some, it represents hatred and ignorance, but to others, mainly Southerners, it can simply be a reminder of home. A familiar image that many have seen since birth. In truth, it is a powerful image, one that has been used for evil and good. But if you see it worn or used by any musicians in this film, trust that it is done to reclaim a symbol stained by hate.
Being raised in Franklin, Tennessee, it was a Civil War town. So the high school that I went to, the mascot of the high school was a rebel flag. We were the Franklin Rebels. The flag itself was always around a little bit more so than normal nowadays. And here in the last, 15, 20 years, you've been able to see how just the flag alone or the rebelness behind it's getting shut down more and more. The Franklin Rebels, they're no longer the rebels. You know, the flag's no longer the mascot of the high school. You know, it's heritage. It's a Civil War town. There are always going to be reenactments going on, but it's just showing how the hills are slowly disappearing in some of the history, and they're getting rid of that to make way for all the concrete jungles that's kind of coming, I guess.
And not that I even support the flag, the rebel flag and all, but because I've changed a lot of feelings on that in the past, 20 years, but I had one on the back of my jacket when I first got off the Greyhound, in Manhattan, And the girl that met me there was like, you better take that off right now, because you can't walk around with that up here. I'm like, really? Well, it just, why? I'm not a racist. I never have been, and I didn't see how it was racist. And a lot of people down here don't see how the flag is racist.
There's a bunch of different angles to look at the flag and racism and all that bullshit, but in the end, it's just kind of representing where you're from and being proud or unproud about it. That's just the way it is.
Dude, there's been a lot of dudes get fucking cunty about our fucking rebel flag on the kick drum, or rebel flags we hang from speakers. There's bands that genuinely dislike us because of our fucking, I don't know. I mean, yeah, everybody's got an angle. I mean, I don't know if that, I guess that's our angle. I mean, it's not like I go to bed fucking, thank you, God, and Jesus, and Rebel John, and fucking... No, man, it jars a few people, and I think that's a good thing.
And I don't go around flying it and stuff. Like, you'll see it, and Phil's got it and stuff, but it's more of just a sense of, like, who we are and what... I know it means a lot of bad shit, but I don't agree with any of that. The coolest one I ever seen, as far as rebel flags, it was just a camouflage green. It was just, so I was like, man, that's cool. It's like, there's no blood on it, It represents the South, but it's like, the fight we're doing, the fight we go through.
I always got to grow up around a lot of tension over that issue and seeing a standoff in the parking lots, black against white and all that stuff. But in the end, everybody's just trying to be proud of where they're from, and it is just a symbol. And fortunately, a lot of hellraisers grasp onto that motherfucker, and it gets a little bit of a bad name, but I don't know. I guess that's what it's about, man.
Man, I'm not fucking out to call black people N-words and every fucking thing and drive everybody mad, but yeah, there's Yankee bands out the nuts that fucking piss me off. They fucking, I remember the Wayward Man. What were they called? There was something before the Wayward.
Yeah.
Carry On, yeah. Yeah, we played with them bitches up in D.C., man, and we had played with them fucking dickheads. Actually, put this on the thing if you'd like. Me and Chuck were out getting beer, and we come back, all we know is we have beer in our hand, and there's... And people out front are like, dude, you hear that thing? Hear what thing? And fucking on the mic, man, their bass player fucking calls us racist. And I don't know. What the fuck to do, man? Hey, wait till we get on their home turf and give me shit? I don't know, because we had a Confederate flag on stage. Dude, I'm not sitting around my house and fucking,
not that guy
raising a
hateful,
Confederate
you know?
Flag and say, all right, for dinner tonight, I appreciate General Lee. I appreciate... I don't know, it's dumb. Either way, it was fucking punk as shit, man. I don't know, man, I should fucking choke that bitch out, man.
We'll be right back.
really to write it, you know, I think you have to live it. There's something inexplicable about being from the South, you know. People have a very big misconception of the region, I think, you know. But I don't think we as people do much to make it very easy on people to understand, because we say what I just said, you kind of got to just be here and live it to understand it.
But I mean, I wouldn't ever tell anyone that Burn the Priest or Lamb of God or Southern Rock.
No.
But I do think there are elements of our music, and there are certain songs and parts of songs, what have you, that have a certain swagger to them and a certain sound to them that is certainly a reflection of where we live and how we grew up and where we're from, you know.
You can tell, in a way, just by hearing it, and it's almost like, this is gonna sound regional centric or whatever, but I think only Southerners can recognize it, you know, because, you know, like a band like the Brotlow, who are fucking awesome, totally try to do that Southern swagger, but it comes across as not being Southern. It comes across as New York City boys with soul, you know. But I don't know, there's just something about, like, when you hear a band from the South, you know they're from the South instantly.
Because it is the South, you're going to get a lot more of the blues and a lot more of the, you know, country, western, and at first you think all that stuff's bullshit, then you realize it's really the roots, and realize the level of musicianship in some of those guys and stuff, and it just helps you come along as you're trying to be a musician, that you might have some more influences than other places, maybe, because, I mean, you're not going to have the influence so much of maybe ZZ Top and Willie Nelson up in fucking Detroit.
My dad listened to a lot of country music, and I love country, and it's one of my biggest influences, and I think you can hear it in my sound for sure, because I try and put it in as much as I can, you know, and I think that's different. You know, you mix that with metal and it's different. You know, it makes more of a bluesier sound, and it's like, and we, you know, we are Southern bands, you know, bend the fucking string, you know.
Even like Jimmy Bauer, he loves country music and always has. And Brent from Mastodon, he's talked about all kinds of country side things he wants to do. And it's wild growing up. All these guys that I've just looked up to that rock so hard, how much they have the love for the Southern sound or acoustic sound.
When you're young and pissed off, you may think, well, it all fucking sucks and metal's the only way to go and you're all fucking idiots for listening to that shit, but then you'll realize that, hey, there's some fucking good stuff in there, and it actually can round you out as a musician.
Are really into classical music. I mean, I played classical piano for years before I even play guitar, and
that's probably like what started getting us into like minor key of music and kind of like understanding music theory a little bit, you know, like playing music like that, you know.
We like using a lot of weird scales too, just like Hungarian scales and
Japanese scales.
Japanese scales are awesome, man. Like, just anything that's weird, but it's like it's spelled out in front of you so you can play around with it and have a weird feel to simple chords and simple dynamics and you know, just structures or whatever to what you're writing, but it's weird notes because it's a Japanese scale or Hungarian. I mean,
different from like the typical, you know, bluesy scale or something like that.
Yeah, like a pentatonic or something.
Well, being from South Florida, like, it was just impossible to get out of it, you know what I mean? It was like, how are we ever gonna get out of here and play other cities, you know? Like, the shows in South Florida were so small, and like there would be this group of people, and you know, then the next time you play, there was nobody or something like that, and then you're just like, how am I ever gonna get out of here? So for me, that was like a little weird, you know.
You were
just,
like 8 hours below where Florida even starts, so that sucks. Yeah, it is. It does suck.
Miami is. It takes you like an entire day just to get to another city, pretty much. So it was always like, we'd do it locally, or we'd spend a day to drive 6 hours to Gainesville to play a party or something. And it wasn't, you know, there was no money involved. You know, it was just kind of like, this is what I do on my free time.
It's a cool thing about touring all over the place. You get to meet everybody. They come here, you get to meet them. We all play shows, we have fun. And so much, and none of us are getting rich. Who cares, you know? What? Would that make it better? You know?
But why you?
What?
Why you? Why not?
Why not? There's got to be one guy in every fucking crowd, whether it be Southern or Northern, and I ain't saying I'm that guy, but I'm one of those guys, that steps up and say, man, we don't give a hot fuck how you do it there. This is how we do it where we're from. You know, it's not why me, it's why us, because we're together. Is how I feel. I mean, we might have little frictions here and there, but all in all, you see a fucking Southern band in New York and y'all play a show together, it's all love. And there's a lot of Jim Beam getting thrown around, you know? That's it, you know? We have pride in what we do. Even if we just play one note and sucked at it, we still back it up 100%, you know? It's just how it is in the South, man.
One band that truly backed up their mouths 100%, without compromise or apologies, was North Carolina's infamous Buzz Oven. Formed in 1989, Buzz Oven embraced their roots and never shied away from their heritage. They were loud, proud, dirty, scary, and Southern.
Buzz Oven to me was like my punk rock. You know, this was like punk rock on a level that I've truly understood. Like, I'm not from California, I'm from the deep South. These guys show up, and it was punk on a whole new level. And I don't think a lot of people understand that unless they're around then, you know, in the South to see Buzz Oven show up to your town. And I'm sure it was like that with I Hate God, too. You know, these bands were our fucking punk.
The grungiest looking motherfuckers I ever saw come out of a van was Buzz Oven, you know, and sure enough, he's got a rebel flag belt buckle and talking about listening to country music in the van and all this shit. And I was like, what the fuck, you know? Because they're playing some pretty mean music.
They weren't ashamed to be from the South. And back then, like, you couldn't be proud to be from the South for any reason. And nobody really respected that you could be a punk rocker from the South, you know? And these guys were fucking, oh yeah, fuck you.
Being from the South wasn't as necessarily important when it first started, but then it just became, you know, like we were like a fucking turd in a punch bowl, you know what I mean? We really stuck out. Of course, until we met I Hate God. I Hate God didn't even know us, and we didn't know them, and, you know, we sounded somewhat alike, not really. I've always thought that they were more like the metal-y version, as where we were more punk rock, you know what I mean? It started to become kind of like a pride factor because, you know, we knew we were the only band out of there doing anything like it. I mean, there was any scene, but they didn't really do what we were doing, you know what I mean? It wasn't such a huge thing, like I say, in the very beginning, but it did as we went out and started touring our asses off. You know, it became like, hey, you know, yeah, we're from North Carolina. I mean, people were surprised, like, you know, we thought only dumb hicks came from there and shit. So we just became more proud of it, you know?
Overall, the attitude and approach about playing music down here tends to seem a little more like natural, and this is just what we do, you know, as opposed to, oh, I'm gonna be in a band and I'm gonna make a record, I'm gonna go on tour and I'm gonna make it. It's like, no, I'm in a band, yeah, with my friends, and oh, we're gonna go on tour, cool, it's gonna be fun, it's gonna be great, you know. It just feels that way. It's like more of an extension of who you are, as opposed to your identity that you've created for yourself.
All Southern bands are familiar with the dirt circuit, the friendly clubs, bars, and houses that support us in towns like Richmond, Virginia, Little Rock, Arkansas. Shreveport, Louisiana. Atlanta, North Carolina, and Tennessee. Hell, shit. Fans and band members look out for each other. We sleep on each other's floors and couches. We stock up on beer and share it freely. We tell stories and laugh and enjoy each other's company. We swap t-shirts and tattoos. We have a great time.
There's a lot of bands that, I don't know, it's a different kind of mentality, I think. You know, it's just, you know, take it as it comes and just play good music and have fun. And, you know, everyone just kind of looks out for each other. And it seems like in different areas around the country that you don't have that kind of camaraderie, you know.
What's funny about bands from the South is you meet them the first time and you feel like you've known them forever, man. You know what I mean? Like, everybody's fucking great, man. You know, like, you meet them for the first time and it's already like you have this bond.
It's weird. It's like, it's a weird family, you know, like, because you, you know, like, you won't see each other for about a year or so, or, you know, a band will come into your town, and it's like, you always, like, it's like a family reunion or something. I don't know, man.
it's family, you know, and that's the one thing that we've always lived by, that creed, is that it's family style. And when we first went on the road, we met a lot of other people who were family on the road, and I know you know this. It's like, to me, that's part of the Southern Rock mentality, was that people took care of each other, take care of their own, and they do it. You know, that's one of the great things about it, you know, and it's a spirit, man. That's the one thing, you know, that you see when I bump into Jimmy Bauer, you know, and you feel that love, or Danny Nick from Suplex.
I've said this a million times. If I was in it for the money, I'd quit when I was 18 years old. You know, there's no money to be made doing it. But the thing that kept us going was the families, you know, the extended families. There was just all these little, you know, Atlanta was always Mastodon, you know, Richmond, ATP, you know, it was like all these little, you know, just, and you just were keeping up with your family, you know, dropping in and coming through, and everybody took care of each other.
Yeah, that's true. A lot of it is going city to city and just hanging out with your friends that you don't see but maybe twice or three times a year. Then you don't realize, like, how awesome they are or how much, you know, you miss them until you see them. You're like, oh, shit, man, great. Yeah, we'll be back in, like, 3 months, you know, it's really cool. Or they'll be back, you know, in your hometown.
This motherfucker will be dead in a week.
Yeah. No whiskey shots after that.
The funny thing is, this is Gary Mader's thigh bone.
Everybody just seems to take great care of everybody else. It's just a big circle. So there isn't anybody that comes through town that we don't try and put up and help out, feed, and do whatever we can. And they always, that's always come back to us. We've always been taken great care of. I mean, we try and give that back and make sure that people are all right when they're on the road. It's tough, you know. It's a bitch. Metal scene that we're a part of, or whatever you want to call it, whatever genre it is definitely an inbred thing. Everybody's family. Everybody looks out for everybody else, and that's the way it's always been with us. It's the way it always will be. So. Nothing tested and ultimately reinforced the family bond in the underground Southern metal community than the chaos that began the morning of August 29th, 2005. Hurricane Katrina hit the Gulf Coast and it showed no mercy. More than 1,800 people lost their lives in the terrible days that followed. There was violence, murder, theft, and rape. New Orleans was hit particularly hard, and many of the bands there lost everything. It took some time to recover, but these same bands eventually demonstrated that nature's worst couldn't kill the music.
To me, I think after Katrina, it really fucking blew up. You know, every scene fluctuates, and we were kind of at a point right before Katrina, and like killer shows would come, nobody would show up, or you know, bands would play and it was like nobody cared. And it was like after Katrina happened, it all got taken away. And fuck, if you like take a bunch of New Orleanians and you take all their shit away, they're gonna get nothing but pissed. It's like one day we went away for the weekend and came back and all my friends were gone and the fucking bar was gone and all the bands were gone and your house is gone.
My house burned down during Katrina. It didn't get flooded, it burned up, like, cause some, I lived in a flop house type place uptown, and I guess some crackhead set it on fire or something, still don't know.
It's like, fuck, you know? So it's like, everyone's like, oh, it's gonna be the end of New Orleans metal, and it's like, no, it's not, dude, no way. These people are so stubborn and fucked up that it's like, no.
Some people are like, oh, music scene's dead. You know, like you read that in a magazine, like, oh, New Orleans, you know, how many years of blues and jazz? It's over. Like, what the fuck you? That's so stupid, man. People were fucking playing the day after Katrina. I mean, people were jamming, you know. I mean, no electricity, just acoustic, just fucking, you know. That's just the way it's gotta be, man. You can't kill a city, man.
You know, we were all kind of forced to begin again immediately, you know, because without warning or question, we had everything taken away.
Everything got blown to shit, you know, for like a half a year or whatever, and then finally everybody came back. And so now we have all the bands that we have now, you know, after all the bullshit that went down.
All these new bands came up, and it was killer, and it was tight, you know, and it still is. And the, you know, everyone started playing again, you know, Hogjaw started playing again, and like Harp came up, and we came up, and the scene seemed to get real strong, and it seems like it still is, you know. It's like, it really, in a kind of fucked up backwards way, totally helped the scene.
It's weird because like we're all more into peace and love and all this stuff that I was never into, but Katrina changed a lot of people's minds down here. You know, everybody's closer, the scene's tighter, as far as like the overall consciousness of like being from the South and being in this band, and like the metal bands and the punk bands, they all get along and everybody's getting along. It's been more like that since Katrina, you know? As horrible as that was, you know? And it's not even just us here in New Orleans. It's like, cause like, you know, everybody down on the Gulf Coast and everywhere, you know? It's like, it's more of like a family type thing, you know?
The Southern Underground really does feel like family. When we're on the road, the connections we have at the next stop make all the difference. No one here is trying to get rich. We don't strive for fame or fortune. For most of us, that is out of the question, and we know it. The music we play and the bonds we form doing it are the best possible rewards. For us, the American South is the best place in the world. The music here is real, and it is happening right now.
Now things are getting a little better, you know, but if I didn't learn the hard way, I don't know if I'd be the same. I would definitely not be the same person I am now, you know? I wouldn't have the same outlook, you know? Some of the guys think I'm a little negative about, like, you know, I have low expectations, but I think I'm just realistic. I don't expect anything big or anything, you know? Like, I'm just going with the flow and, you know, we'll see what happens, you know, because you never know. You never know what's gonna happen.
We're fortunate to be in a position where we get a lot more exposure than a lot of these bands. So if the Hot Topic kid that listens to Lamb of God can go see Lamb of God and get turned on to Wake or Sour Vein or something like that, because, you know, that can get that kid a little bit deeper into the underground and really, you know, start exposing people that, you know, to stuff they wouldn't necessarily find, you know.
Keep underground music very much alive, man. Even, you know, you gotta come to the shows, man. You gotta throw up extra $5. Just keep it alive, man, because it's the truest form of music that there is. Like, and I mean, every band wants to strive to be bigger, but the underground's where it's at, man. I mean, to be big in the underground is to prove your point to yourself and to others, man. It's that you can do it without anybody's help.
You know, go for it, man. If I can do it, you can do it, trust me.
You know?
I mean, that's why it's the underground scene. It's, the shit is underground. It's not like these bands are selling records like Britney Spears, you know? There's only a few that are like high caliber, like Lamb of God and things like that, you know? Other than that, everyone below that has a certain level they're hitting, and there's just people, there's millions of people that don't even know about it.
we are that band that used to all sleep in the van if we didn't have nowhere to stay at the you know, on the side of the interstate at the rest stop. We are that band that would call the buddies that they played a couple shows with, and can we crash on your floor or borrow a cabinet? And you know, we did all those things, and so those did absolutely existed, and we still know a lot of those people.
Weed Eater stays at my house to this day, so.
I don't know, me and I think everyone that I know from the South, you know, it's not necessarily the easiest place to grow up or to live. There's not, you know, we've been the workhorse for the country forever, and there's never been a lot of reciprocation as far as that goes. It just seems like the money is, any money that's made off of the area that I live in doesn't stay there. It's someone else has got their hand in the pie, and it's just been that way for everything from music to going to the grocery store. It's all the same, but it definitely makes for a different kind of upbringing, a different perspective on things, and it makes you feel like it's almost impossible and you have to work hard for anything that you're going to get. And everybody that I know lives by that adage, and that's just the way it is.
It's just an uphill bullshit struggle, man. This shit's all about poverty, man. This is what this Southern Steel shit is. There ain't no retirement. There ain't no fucking groovy old-timers place to be, man. And that's just the bitch of it, man. We're gonna fucking work till the day we die. Hopefully we can play some tunes in between.
I couldn't imagine wanting to do or be part of anything else, but it's a business. Like, you're trying to make a living, trying to put food in your mouth and gas in the fucking gas tank at the end of the day to get to the next show. Your ultimate goal is not just to survive tour to tour, but to have an end result where you can actually maybe mail a fucking mortgage payment home from the road. It could happen. It can happen. If you have the mindset to, like, want to get there, you can make it happen. You just have to structure it a little better, you know?
The South is fucking raw, and it's fucking dirty, and it's working, you know? And it's working because we have to, and we don't fucking mind because, you know, it's just the way it goes. You want to get it done, you got to do it. And if you don't have the heart to do it, then you don't really need to be doing it. You'll get trampled, you know? Get the fuck out. Don't waste my time.
Whatever way the fucking musical climate goes, our only hope is it comes and meets us. If we go to bend and meet the musical climate, we don't miss it. It's gonna fucking go far the other way. We're staying strictly straight ahead, and if it hits us, we're lucky. And that's all fucking music is. If you hit big, you're lucky, and most people ain't lucky.
And that's what's kind of unfortunate with a lot of other scenes. They think of the persona, and they get caught up into, you know, I'm gonna be on MTV and all this other stupid shit, when, you know, you should just really play music for the love of playing music. That's what it's about.
It creates a situation where everyone can just honestly make good songs and make good music without this band competition thing that happens so much, you know, in, say, other urban areas like New York or Cleveland or whatever, Chicago, you know. It's just, it feels really organic.
And the pride that I see come out of the South and Southern bands are like, look, we got this chance, we're gonna go get it. Like, I mean, like, people are like urgent, you know. And I see these bands from like Rhode Island or Minneapolis and stuff, they just don't have the same fire we got, dude, because we're born to lose. I'm not saying that these guys from up north don't have pride or whatever, but they just ain't showing it the same way. I mean, for us, man, it's now or never, and that's the way we walk it like we talk it, you know what I mean?
The South made me a better fucking person, I feel like. Fucking top to bottom, man. Without the South, there's not a beating back to people. Without the riffs, there's not a beating back. Without the South, there's not the riffs. I don't know. It's rock and roll 101, man.
Home's where your heart is, and this is where my heart is.
You know, this is what it's all about.
Me and the bands I met from the South, man, we're in it to win it, and we're going for it, you know. We go for the throat.
Being born and raised in the South, of course I have a certain bit of pride or a longing for home. Put it this way, I don't want to die anywhere else but the fucking South.
I was in Portland, just, I went up to see Corrupted, and I went out to this karaoke bar with some friends, you know, and I was fucking shit-faced, dude. Behind the bar, grabbing beers, you know, I was like, fuck Oregon, Texas, motherfuckers, you know, like.
We're kind of stuck in time, almost, you know, what we were doing then, we're still doing the same damn thing. We just have less hair and a little bit more of a gut, you know, that's about it.
Can we smoke weed on camera?
Yeah, please.
Fuck.
There you go, CT.
And he was stuck in this little black room, and he was going and making all these weird noises and freaking out, dude. And so anyway, we went on this fucking acid trip together and all this crap and whoa and all this, wow, whoa, we almost, oh Jesus.
Apparently during the whole thing, some other dude that was his friend comes up with a shovel trying to hit our bass player, and another dude shows up a gun. It's like, I wouldn't do that if I was you. Puts the gun up to his head, and all I can remember, you know, is Kurt being like, the show fucking rules, you know, just all stoked, you know.
The players are insane. Thank you, sir.
It's been weeks.
I mean, the last time I puked was at a fucking bar with a fucking blind pig and, you know, bikes and big trucks and fucking redneck motherfuckers. No, Duce!
I can't write songs about dragons or, you know, swords or whatever, shit like that, you know? We're not Manowar, you know, but although Manowar's pretty cool, but, I think the lack of pressure will allow us to play until we're as old as Saxon. I think I can be Biff Byford, Biff, whatever the fuck, that old, you know, denim and leather brought us all together. This next song is about death. It's called Death.
I forgot what we were even talking about.
It doesn't matter, because all this stuff is stuff that I can use, so.
I went brain dead all of a sudden. It happened.
He was good until it
happened. Dude, yeah, a draft beer and cheap Coke. Fuck you. I got a shit. Oh my God. Pull me out of bed for this. What's next? Let's go.